Welcome to this edition of Under the Radar for Saturday, August 5th. And this week we're going to be looking at some more lunacy on university campus, because where else would you look, quite frankly? And first up, college requires deep commitment to marginalised from new hires. Applicants for a vacant professorship at Providence College must demonstrate a deep commitment to marginalised groups, according to a recent job posting. As our student body and sociology majors in particular grow increasingly diverse, we have a strong preference for publicly engaged scholarship and candidates with interest in student-centred pedagogical and mentoring practices, a description for the school's open tenure track assistant professor of sociology position declares. Moreover, as students of colour and their allies have demanded in college and university protests across the nation, we support the students' desire to hire faculty who demonstrate a deep commitment to and proven ability in supporting the success of students from historically marginalised economic, social and cultural groups. The job description states, adding that preference will be given to candidates with an expertise in critical race theory and intersectionality, or in other words, an expertise in postmodernist bullshit. Basically, behind all the flowery rhetoric, all you've done is fold to the tantrums of social justice lunatics to justify hiring decisions based on race. Now, the college was quick to clarify. Associate Vice President for Public Affairs Stephen Morano told Campus Reform that this is not a requirement that Providence College wants to implement across the board. The longer answer is that this is a position in our sociology department and they are specifically looking for a professor with expertise in W.E.B. Du Bois' critical race theory and intersectionality and/or economic sociology, he added. In order to do the work required and teach the necessary courses, that department desires a new hire who demonstrates a deep commitment to and proven ability in supporting the success of students from historically marginalized economic, social, and cultural groups. It doesn't matter how you dress it up. Basically, you're just hiring people by their race and ideology. So I suppose it's possible to find a white professor that has an expertise in critical race theory, but let's face it, this is an affirmative action hire and nothing more. One of the issues lost in the Brett Weinstein Evergreen State University saga around the day of absence was the proposed controversial new strategic equity plan endorsed by the newly appointed President George Bridges, which amongst other things was calling for more diversity in hiring, or basically hiring more people of colour. Now, in Evergreen's case, that was university-wide. Providence says this is just the sociology department, which, let's face it, if you're taking sociology at just about any college these days, well, you're probably blowing your money anyway. But how long until the termites spread? Surely STEM fields are safe, right? Well, remember just a couple of months ago, I reported that the overtly racist assistant professor of mathematics, Piper Harron, who called on universities to stop hiring white cis men and insisted that real solutions require women of colour and trans women. Well, she's only a temporary assistant professor, so perhaps she can safely be ignored. But not so in engineering. Take the newly appointed dean of Purdue's School of Engineering Education, Dr. Donna Riley. The following comes from her bio at her former place of employment, Smith College. My scholarship currently focuses on applying liberative pedagogies in engineering education, leveraging best practices from women's studies and ethnic studies to engage students in creating a democratic classroom that encourages all voices. Or in other words, shut up, white people, the minorities are talking. In 2005, I received a career award from the National Science Foundation to support this work, which includes developing, implementing, and assessing curricula and pedagogical innovations based on liberative pedagogies and student input at Smith, and understanding how students at Smith conceptualize their identities as engineers. Why would you need to conceptualize your identity as an engineer? I thought being an engineer was about building and creating things. Who gives a shit what the identity of the creator is? I mean, I know it's a silly question. Identitarian ideologues, that's who cares. But I think most of us just want to know that if you build a bridge, that we can reliably cross over it. I seek as an engineering educator to be part of a paradigm shift that these pedagogies demand, repositioning concerns about diversity in science and engineering from superficial measures of equity as headcounts to addressing justice and the genuine engagement of all students as core educational challenges. Buzzword salad. Repositioning concerns about diversity in science. Just be honest about it. You want to shoehorn in your own personal hobby horse of social justice because reasons. But wait, there's more. I seek to revise engineering curricula to be relevant to a fuller range of student experiences and career destinations, integrating concerns related to public policy, professional ethics, and social responsibility, decentering Western civilization and uncovering contributions of women and other underrepresented groups. So in other words, Western civilization is evil and it was created by white men, therefore we need to get rid of them and make way for women and minorities. Well, at least the part on uncovering the contributions of women and other underrepresented groups won't take long to cover. And then in one of the subjects she teaches, EGR 330, Engineering and Global Development, we examine how technology influences and is influenced by globalization, capitalism, and colonialism, all evils of white males, and the role technology plays in movements that counter these forces. Gender is a key thread running through the course in examining issues of water supply and quality, food production, and energy. Yes, I'm sure it will be. And you'll be happy to know in EGR 205, we take up racist and colonialist projects in science, as well as the role of technology, culture, and economic systems in the drive toward bigger, faster, cheaper, and more automated production of goods. A course theme around technology and control provides for exploration of military, information, reproductive, and environmental applications. Using readings from philosophy, science, and technology studies, and feminist and post-colonial science studies, we explore these topics and encounter new models of science and engineering that are responsive to ethical concerns. What happened to just learning how to build a bridge? Anyone? And while we're here, why don't we check out some of the great Professor Riley's publications? Feminisms in Engineering Education, Transformative Possibilities. Engineering and Social Justice. You're all a bunch of fucking feminists. Well said. Addressing the perceived conflict between gender and professional identities using the Montreal Massacre. Power Knowledge, using Foucault to promote critical understandings of content and pedagogy in engineering thermodynamics. There you go. There's your postmodernist indoctrination. Common Ground, how a course collaboration between engineering and women's studies produced fine art. I'm sure it did. The Art of Engineering, using fine arts to discuss the lives of women faculty in engineering. Who cares? Employing liberative pedagogies in engineering education. And finally, Sex, Fear, and Condescension on Campus. Cyber Censorship at Carnegie Mellon University. Now, thankfully, she hasn't actually published anything for 8 years, but given that publications list, surely her hire at Purdue is a diversity hire. Are you telling me there isn't a better qualified person for Dean of Engineering Education without all the postmodernist social justice baggage? Indrik Wickman, a professor of engineering at Michigan State University, noted that Purdue was once called the MIT of the Midwest. Here's what he had to say of Riley's agenda. Riley's purpose seems not to be how best to train new engineers, but to let everyone know how bad engineers have been, how they continue to oppress women and persons of color, how much we need diverse perspectives, and how the struggle continues to level all distinctions and differences in society. He then goes on to say, nobody wants to see an uncoordinated doofus on the NBA basketball court simply to add diversity. We pay to see top-notch talent compete for victory. We should apply the same standards to engineering and stop pretending that we can game our wonderful profession so that anyone can succeed. Nor should we attack engineering's foundations, its dominantly Western character, so that non-Westerners might suffer fewer microaggressions and somehow feel better about studying it. What is won without effort is surely without merit, and what is torn down and trampled will not easily be raised up again. We'd better tread carefully. Absolutely. And if Purdue wants to pursue social justice as its core value, then it should come out and say so. Jonathan Haidt put this succinctly in his distinction between social justice university and truth university.
So in my talk, I'm going to argue that no university can pursue both. Individuals can in their own lives, but a university needs to have a central mission and it has to be either truth or social justice. It can't be both. And so I'm going to argue that we need a schism. We need our universities to clearly declare which way are you going. You can go either way. It's a free country, but you got to go one way or the other. And you have to be explicit about it, advertise that, and then students can choose which kind of university to go to.
So if you're thinking about a career in engineering, you might want to steer clear of Purdue, because instead of offering an education in engineering, they're trying to engineer education. So, is it time to abandon the universities altogether, or should we just give in to our social justice overlords? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. I'll see you next time.